Hello and welcome to today's program of the Commonwealth Club of California. My name is Kevin O'Malley. I'm chairman of the Business and Leadership Forum here at the club, and I'm your host for tonight. Our program for tonight features Michael Meyer, Designing Imperatives, and we are, I'm sorry, I just lost my place for a second. Michael is going to be speaking about a wonderful talk tonight that I have heard part of already. I'm very excited about it. But let me tell you a little bit about him. Michael Meyer is the CEO of Adaptive Path here in San Francisco. They also have offices in Austin and a new office in Amsterdam. Michael comes to Adaptive Path from Frog Design, where he leads the company's California studio, where he led the company's California studio as general manager, overseeing the firm's physical and digital product design offering. Previously, he started and led the product strategy practice at IDEO's Boston office. Not only has Meyer spearheaded tremendous operational achievements, combining Frog's Palo Alto and San Francisco offices into a single group, he's also led a wide range of projects, planning a new line of home electrical devices, crafting the vision and expressing the value proposition for a major pharmaceutical company's internet presence, developing a next-generation electronic payment token, and leading the cockpit and cabin design of a new jet aircraft. Before Meyer's move to product development consulting, he served as a lieutenant in the U.S. Navy, running a naval telecommunications facility in Naples, Italy, as general manager. Prior to that, he managed the production and testing of shipboard nuclear power plants as a Navy engineering officer. Meyer has a bachelor's degree in physics from the University of California, Berkeley, and an MBA from Harvard Business School. He holds an appointment as a fellow of the Batten Institute, Darden GSBA, University of Virginia, where he's taught early-stage innovation and product development. He currently instructs at the Rady School of Management at University of California, San Diego. And so Michael actually was a rocket scientist. when you say it's not rocket science, well, it is rocket science. And it's all the way from rocket science to the Roman Empire and NASA and everything in between. I'm very excited to introduce Michael Meyer.
Thank you, and good evening and welcome. So I'd like to start off by telling you a little story, and it's actually not my story, right? It's not about me, it's not about any of my friends or my family, it's not about anybody that I've really worked with closely. It's a story that I heard when I was at IDEO, and I was on a project for a company called Corning. Corning makes Corningware. I imagine that most everybody in this room either knows or has used Corningware. Is there anybody that doesn't know what it is? Okay, for everybody who's too scared to actually raise their hand and say that they don't know what it is, let me give you the brief background on Corningware. So Corningware, it's this nice sort of pottery white dish thing. Pretty much, there's a stack of them in basically every grandmother's kitchen cupboard. Pretty much every American has fond memories of Corningware, because it's the sort of thing that our grandmothers or our mothers would pull out and make our favorite dishes. And I was actually just talking with some people in Amsterdam about this, and I showed this image of an American casserole, and I pretty much confirmed every bad image that Europeans have about American cuisine. So if you go to Amsterdam and people are giving you grief about casseroles, I apologize. That's where it came from. Anyway, Corningware is amazing stuff, right? It looks like this white pottery. It's actually a very technical ceramic material. It's called pyroceram, which is really just a fancy name for really, really good glass. So I'm just going to call it glass. Pyroceram, or this really good glass, it's amazing stuff, right? It's pretty much impossible to break it. You can bang on it with kitchen utensils and it won't chip. You can drop it on the ground and it won't shatter. At least it won't shatter the first dozen times or so. Don't try that at home. You can treat it just really, really poorly, get it all dirty and baked on stuff, and with a little bit of elbow grease, it'll scrub up and it'll look basically brand new, which makes it awesome stuff. Unless you're the people who actually manufacture it and try to sell it, because people don't break it. It just gets handed down from generation to generation. So when somebody wants a new set of Corningware, they usually just ask one of their relatives, and they get a brand new set of Corningware. Actually, it's not new. It just looks brand new. So I heard this story that I'm going to tell you in a few minutes. I heard this story when I was at Corning, and we were working on the new generation of Corningware. What Corningware had discovered was that there was this opportunity for them. There was this new generation of daughters who really weren't interested in having this old piece of Corningware handed down from their grandmothers and their mothers. They wanted a new piece of Corningware, something different. And we were setting out to understand what they wanted in the new piece of Corningware and to design it for them. Now, before we get started with the story, I'd actually like to talk a little bit about Corning. I mentioned that this was really, really awesome glass. You might think that the people who can make this really, really awesome glass could do all sorts of wonderful things with glass, and you would be right. In fact, you might imagine that the people who can do that can make this awesome glass and can do these incredible things with glass might be the kind of people that you would go to if you had a really, really difficult glass problem. And they are. In fact, they know glass so well that when NASA was designing the space shuttle and they needed something that could be very durable, could withstand the tremendous heat of reentry, could form itself to these really complex aerodynamic shapes and protect the underlying aluminum structure of the space shuttle, they went to Corning and they asked, you know, you make this awesomely good glass that doesn't break, that withstands high temperatures, could you make some sort of insulating tiles for the space shuttle? And Corning said, well, yes, of course we can, and set off and designed the tiles that protect the space shuttle in reentry. And they've been in service for, gosh, I don't know how long, dozens of years. How long?
About 40 years.
A long time. And served very well. So you might ask yourself, what leads a company to have that kind of confidence that they know a material so well, that they can form it into whatever shape, fit it to whatever function it needs to serve? And if you thought about the, if you wondered about what the name of this talk, Proximus Maximus, actually means, and you pulled out your Latin dictionaries, you might go, oh, right, I know, it's proximity, right? It's all about being close to something. I don't know close to what, but it's got to be about proximity. I think maybe so, but I think it's probably also a little bit more subtle than that. There are all sorts of people out there telling us about how we need to be close to this, close to that, be close to your customers, be close to your employees, be close to, you know, whatever, be close to nature. It seems like the solution is always be close to something. I think that it's a little bit more subtle than that. The Romans knew that it was really, really good to be close to some things. They built the aqueducts so that they could bring the water into the cities. Italy is, I used to live in Italy. Italy is literally littered with these things. You almost can't turn around without knocking one down, except that they won't fall down because they built them so well. So the Romans really understood you want to be close to water. They also understood that there were some things that you don't necessarily want to be close to. Can anybody guess what we're looking at in this picture? Yeah. This is a picture of the Cloaca Maxima. Any Latin fans out there know what that means? Cloaca Maxima basically means really big sewer. The Romans were great engineers. As far as naming things, I think that, you know, they were pretty straightforward. Anyway, the Romans understood that, yes, it's great to be close to water. The stuff that happens after you've used the water, not so great to be close to. So I actually think it's more of, that's one example. Another example from the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire, as we talk about it, was huge, right? There was no way that anybody could be close to every part of the Roman Empire. When the emperor wanted to get stuff done, he didn't ride out to the edges of the empire. When he wanted to collect the taxes, he didn't ride out to the edges of the empire. He relied on a network of people who could be close to the different parts of the empire, and he worked through them. He worked through this network of governors, and the governors had to be close to the people in their individual provinces. They had to understand what was going on. They had to be able to represent Rome in all her glory and all her beauty and make the same decisions that the emperor would make. It was a system that worked very, very well. It had been in place for about 500 years up until this point, this governor is about to make a very, very bad decision, condemning somebody to be crucified. But what's interesting is that this same system of governors representing the emperor spread out through the empire, out into the provinces, continued to exist for another 500 years after this really, really bad decision. So I think that it's very tempting to say that the solution, it's very tempting to say that the solution to designing great things, to running a business, is all about proximity. But I think it's actually more complex than that. It's about managing proximity, right? It's about defining the dimensions about what could you be close to, what could you be far away from. Who are the people who could be close? Who are the people who could be far away? And then deciding who should be close to what. And just as importantly, who should be far away from what. So I haven't yet told you the story that I heard. The story that I heard was actually about these. Not about movie stars, not about jet pilots, but about sunglasses, actually. Does anybody know what photochromic sunglasses are? A couple of hands. The same people that knew Cloaca Maxima. Photochromic sunglasses, they're the glasses that get light when you go inside and they get dark when you go outside, right? They're very, very practical, very, very functional, totally not sexy. They will not make you be like Tom Cruise and they will not get you the girl. However, they're really great sunglasses. So the story that I heard was how photochromic sunglasses were actually invented. They were invented by this gentleman, Dr. Stanley D. Stuckey. He's a material scientist specializing in glass. You can see him here with his, posing very proudly, I think, with his most famous creation, Corningware. He holds dozens, literally dozens of patents, and is probably responsible for hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars, of revenue for Corning Incorporated. A really great guy. And he's the guy who invented these photochromic sunglasses. So I was at one of these dinners and drinks after the main meetings of the day had happened. And I was standing there with a drink, and I was talking with one of the engineers. It wasn't Dr. Stuckey. I was talking with one of the engineers or scientists, and he was saying, "Hey, you know, have you ever wondered how some of this great stuff came to be?" So we've been talking about all of the great stuff that Corning makes. He said, have you ever wondered how some of this great stuff came to be?" I'm like, "No, I hadn't. Do you have a good story?" He's like, "Yeah, I've got a great story." He said, "Okay, so photochromic sunglasses. You know what photochromic sunglasses are?" I'm like, "They're the ones that get dark and then light." I'm like, "Okay." See, the way that they were invented, the team that was buying the glass from us, we were making the glass, somebody else was making the glass into sunglasses. It was Bausch and Lomb or Luxottica or one of those guys. I literally don't remember. They were at Corning. They were visiting the Corning plant, talking with the Corning scientists and engineers. And it was one of those typical kind of supplier meetings where everybody sits down and asks, "Hey, how could we make this better?" You know, and the answers you get are usually, "Well, you could deliver it faster. You could make it cheaper. You could make it lighter. You could make it stronger." Pretty much the standard thing. So they had a day worth of those meetings. Got to the end of it, nothing terribly interesting happened. Got together for one of those evenings of dinner and drinks, and afterwards, Dr. Stuckey was standing there talking to one of the marketing guys from Bausch and Lomb or Luxottica or wherever, and the marketing guy said, "You know, you asked this question earlier. How could you make the glass better?" And I wanted to say, but I didn't say it because I knew that it was impossible. I wanted to say, "You know, if you could make glass that would get dark in the sunlight and then get light when you get out of the sunlight, that would be great. But I know that you can't make glass like that." So, you know, I wasn't going to embarrass myself by bringing it out in front of everybody. And he kind of laughed nervously because he knew it was impossible. Dr. Stuckey laughed nervously as well because he knew that sitting back in his lab, he actually had a piece of glass that would do exactly that. And so the next day, as they were having the follow-up meetings, Dr. Stuckey comes walking in, and he's got this piece of glass, and he says, "Hey, I've got something I want to show you guys." Everybody's like, "Okay." And he holds it up. And they say, "It's glass." He says, "Yes, it's glass. Let's go outside." Walks outside, everybody follows him outside, they go outside. As soon as it hits the sunlight, it starts turning dark. And everybody goes, "Ooh." He's like, "Let's go inside." Walk inside, they get inside into the shade, and it starts getting light. And everybody goes, "Ah." because they can see what he's getting at, right? They make sunglasses. He's got this amazing piece of glass. Boom, photochromic sunglasses are made. This is an awesome story. I have absolutely no idea whether or not it's true. In fact, I suspect that it may not be exactly true. Certainly, Dr. Stuckey has the patent for photochromic glass. The details of the story, I don't know. I actually did a little bit of fact-checking, and what I discovered was Dr. Stuckey had been retired for several years by the time that I was there and heard this story. So I certainly wasn't talking to him. Maybe I was talking to somebody who was on his team. More likely, I was talking to somebody who had heard it from somebody who had heard it from somebody. So anyway, I literally don't know if this story is true, and honestly, I do not care, right? I don't care because it is a story that stuck with me for a long time, and I've tried to figure out exactly why it stuck with me for so long. And it was only just recently that I figured it out. It's to do with the inside story, right? Everybody loves to hear the inside story of how that thing was made. Everybody loves to tell the inside story of how that thing was made. Everybody loves to be at the center of the story of how that thing was made. And the interesting thing about design, product development, especially these days, is that because of the complexity of the problem of designing, building, and delivering the products, services, and experiences that we create these days, everybody has got an opportunity to be the person at the center of that story of how the thing was made, or at least some aspect of the story of how that thing was made. So the natural question then is, okay, great, how do we do that? How do we put people at the center of the story of how that thing was made? So let's think a little bit about how Dr. Stuckey got to the center of that story, right? He knew glass very, very well. There were other people who knew glass very, very well. These are some images of some of the earliest glass that's known to exist. Roman glass. One of the reasons that we know the Roman glass was some of the earliest to exist is that there is actually a written record of it. There's also remains have been found. And the Romans also were really, really shrewd about breaking up other people's glass and using it as raw material for their own glass. So they kind of erased all of the history that came before. So we don't know if it's exactly the first glass, but it's certainly some of the earliest glass. And this is what we think of when we think of Roman glass. Fairly basic, fairly functional, a slightly misshapen artisan glass. This is also Roman glass, much more elegant, much more refined, much more structural. It's amazing to me that this piece here on the left has actually survived thousands of years, largely intact, or at least intact enough that it could be restored. So you kind of have to wonder, how could people who created glass like this, very basic, very functional, also create glass that was really at the cutting edge of their own technology? When they clearly were not technologists, right? They were excellent engineers. They could get water and sewage from one place to another very well. They could build roads very well. Their knowledge of chemistry was a little bit lacking. These were the people who thought that if you left a piece of meat out, flies would spontaneously generate from it. They were a little bit lacking in the basic sciences, yet they understood this glass so well. I think that the reason that they understood the glass so well is that they literally lived with it. This is a scene of a typical Roman glassmaker's studio, and you can see there's the one guy who's dad, there's a woman who's mom, there's a bunch of kids who are the kids, and this is what they do. They eat, drink, breathe, sleep glass. They're constantly surrounded by the tools, constantly surrounded by the materials, constantly surrounded by the successful and the failed attempts at making things out of glass. I think that as a result of this, they developed a tremendous sense of empathy for the glass, that they had this emotional closeness, this deep intuitive understanding of what could and could not be done with glass that replaced the knowledge of chemistry. I think it's interesting that we actually, in the design field, we actually recreate this kind of experiential learning, this kind of empathy building with the materials that we use. When we go off, has anybody taken a drawing class, a life drawing class? a few people. So the first thing that you did was you sat down with a blank piece of paper and a piece of charcoal and you did this, right? No. Even if we had the talent to do this in our very first drawing class, we wouldn't have had the skills to do this. We wouldn't have had the knowledge of the materials, how to bend them to our will. We wouldn't have been able to craft this. Instead, we sat down with a couple of sheets of different kinds of paper, a bunch of different kinds of charcoal, maybe some pencils, maybe some pens, and we drew lines. I mean, it was, when I took my first drawing class, it was a little bit of an epiphany for me because, you know, I sat down and with all of these materials, and the instructor says, okay, sit down and play with them, draw some lines. Like, you gotta be kidding me. How much am I paying you? Okay, so I drew a line, okay? Drew another line, pushed a little harder, used a little different side of the charcoal, went a little slower, went a little faster, longer, shorter, started like pushing around the charcoal with my finger, scrubbing it down, discovered that I could create all of these very different effects with the same piece of charcoal and the same piece of paper. So then I grabbed another piece of paper and I started doing it all over again. And then I grabbed another piece of charcoal, a different one, and I did that and with a pencil. And after a while, I started to get this sense of, oh, I can achieve a lot of different effects with these different materials. And I started having this intuitive understanding of it. And I think that the design field has done an excellent job of instilling in people a need, this need to be close to the materials, to develop empathy for the materials. The thing that we should ask ourselves then is, okay, so how do we use that understanding now, right? Because we're not blowing glass. We're not drawing with charcoal. We're making cell phones. We're building wireless data networks. We're sending people to the moon. We're doing much more complex things than that. Do we just get everybody really close to like all of the materials that we're using for that? I would say no, right? For every individual that is engaged in some act of technical artistry, there is some core that they're working with. Right? Some essential material that they have that they can use to craft that product, service, or experience. How do I know that? I know that because I've been in a lot of weird fields, and I've had exactly that experience. Let me introduce you to my favorite core. This is the U.S. Navy D2W reactor. Actually, it's not. It's a representation of a D2W. If I actually showed you one, I'd probably get in some very, very serious trouble with some people who would not like me to show you what a real reactor core looks like. But this is pretty close, and it's actually, this graphic was created by the same people who designed the D2W core, so it's actually reasonably close. Let me point out a couple of interesting aspects of my friend here. So this right here, cleverly labeled reactor core, is the reactor core. That's basically the thing that gets hot. This yellow, the yellow loop, is a loop of water. It's the hottest water in the whole thing. It circulates through there. It carries the heat away from the reactor core, and it carries it over to another thing called the steam generator, which is this thing over here that has little clouds of steam up at the top of it. The steam generator is part of a second loop, very cleverly named the secondary loop. Navy engineers are almost as ingenious as Roman engineers were in their naming conventions. We send this really hot water around. We transfer the heat over to the other water in the steam generator. We pull it off as steam. We send it through a turbine. That goes out through a set of reduction gears, and it turns the propeller at the back of the ship. There is one thing that is very, very important. You can never have steam in the reactor core. Never. If you do, all sorts of horrible and nasty things are going to happen. We've all seen the China syndrome and all that. That's what happens. So we never want to have steam in the reactor core. There's only one place in that primary loop where you're allowed to have steam. It's this little thing up here that looks like a little stick sticking up. That's called the pressurizer, again. Navy engineers are really, really clever when it comes to naming things. The function of the pressurizer is to keep the primary loop under pressure so that it all stays water. As you're training to be a nuclear engineer, you train in all of the sort of the normal operations, starting the reactor up, shutting it down, making the ship go faster, making the ship go slower, making electricity, not making electricity, all of the normal things. You also train on all of the abnormal things. Oops, this broke. Oops, that broke. Oh, we have to do this abnormal configuration. And when things get really, really tense and really, really broken, you're taught to rely on a fundamental understanding and empathy with the water. And I remember when that was kind of instilled in me, when I had that realization. I was a student engineering officer. I was standing there in the control room, and things were going just all over the place. The instruments weren't working. People were yelling and screaming. Dogs and cats living together. It was anarchy. And I was kind of like at a loss of what to do next. And the instructor leans over to me and asks, "So what does the water want to do?" I'm like, "What? What does the water want to do? Does it want to be steam? Does it want to be water? Does it want to go someplace? Does it want to stay where it is? What does the water want to do?" And the lesson that he was trying to instill in me was that if you can have this understanding of what the water wants to do, where it wants to go, what it wants to be, then as things go wrong, fundamentally, you could still control it. If you didn't have that intuitive understanding, then as things went wrong, you would just be baffled. So now you guys all know what you need to know to go out and operate a nuclear reactor. So go have fun. So I said that I've had a couple of these weird career choices. When I left Navy Nuclear Engineering, I realized that the only way that mid-level engineering managers became anything other than mid-level engineering managers was to go off and discover how money was made. And so I went off to a little business school on the banks of the Charles. And at first, when I first got there, I thought that I was learning all of these technical things by rote, right? I was learning bookkeeping and marketing and all of these functional things as functional things. And then when I got into the second year of the program and we started kind of stitching things together, I realized that what I was really learning was getting this intuitive sense of money. Where does the money want to go? Does it want to stay here? Does it want to go over there? Does it want to be with these people? Does it want to be with those people? Is it getting wasted? Is it getting concentrated? Having that intuitive sense of money is something that is fundamental to being a business person. And it was one of the first things that I actually brought to bear when I went to IDEO. One of the first projects that I was on there, it was the Corningware project, actually. One of the first projects that I was on there, I remember I was there, we were in the research phase, and we were trying to figure out, okay, what does this Corningware, the new Corningware, want to be? And I'm standing there in the store, and I'm looking at the display racks, and I'm thinking, money is not getting made here. And I had no idea why, but I just knew money was not getting made there. And I'm looking around, and I'm looking around, and we knew that the way that people bought cookware, they didn't decide, oh, I want this brand of this piece of this brand and this size and whatever and go to the store and get it. They decided, I need a frying pan. And then they go to the store and they look at the rack of frying pans. They pick them up, they hold them, they pretend that they're the French chef and flip some flapjacks. And then they decide which one to buy. And I'm standing there and I'm looking at all of these frying pans and baking sheets and cookie sheets and bread loaf pans, and there's not a piece of Corningware to be found. But they make all of these things, or at least at the time they made all of these things. Over in the casseroles, they're all over it, but they're not anywhere over here. I'm like, well, that's interesting. So I find the stock boy, the guy who puts the stuff out on the shelves, and I ask him, hey, this stuff, the Corningware stuff, it's why isn't it over here? It's over here in this pile, kind of at the end of the aisle. And he looks at it, and he looks at the wall, and he looks at it, and he looks at the wall, and he looks at me and says, it doesn't belong. I'm like, what do you mean it doesn't belong? They're frying pans. He's like, yeah, but they're not really frying pans. Frying pans are like shiny metal, or they're enameled, or they're this dark aluminum. This stuff, I don't know what it is, but it's not a frying pan. And so that's when I realized not just that money was not getting made, but why money was not getting made. because the material of Corningware didn't participate in this visual merchandising. And when I could put it into those terms of, you're not making money with these frying pans because they don't participate in the visual merchandising, because they don't have the distinctive visual elements that are characteristic of frying pans. I could then tell the business people what we needed to do. We needed to make Corningware frying pans that looked like frying pans. And I could tell my colleagues, the industrial designers on the team, hey, we need to make some frying pans out of Corningware that look like frying pans, if we can do it. And so that was my experience of this sort of larger world of having some kind of technical, practicing some kind of technical artistry that translates into a participation in the design process. And it was all because I was focusing on the core, which was different from this industrial designer's core, and getting a tremendous sense of empathy with that core. Awesome. Huh. So what does that mean for us these days? Well, these days, as I mentioned, the programs that we work on are much, much larger, much, much more complex, much, much more technically involved than the programs than the simpler times of product development. And I think it's really well exemplified by the American Space Program, right? At the time when President Kennedy set out this challenge to send a man to the moon and return him safely to the Earth, obviously it had not been done. It was largely felt to be impossible, or at least not possible with the current technology and the current engineering and the current products that were out there. And it was this huge effort to develop the product, the system, that would do this. And I think that there is an interchange that happened early on in the program that's really illustrative of the danger that we face in these very technically complex, large-scale development efforts. And I actually have a little bit of a video that I'd like to share with you that I think illustrates it well.
Take it easy with that.
Where are you planning on putting a window?
Window? There's no window.
No window? What? What about the hatch?
The hatch?
Yeah, the hatch. We need a hatch with explosive bolts that we can open ourselves.
I think there is something you do not understand. This is the final form of the capsule. No hatch.
What would happen if the automatic controls went out?
Backups, checks, etc. This would not happen.
I said, what would happen if it did?
The pilot would have to fly it back.
This is the way it is.
You know, I wonder how the press can feel about this.
What does the press have to say about it?
Yeah, what do they have to say about it?
Well, do you boys know what makes this bird go up? Funding makes this bird go up.
That's right.
No Bucks, no Buck Rogers.
And press over there.
They all want to see Buck Rogers, and that's us, Buck Rogers.
You see, those fellas over there, they've been making us out as the 7 finest and bravest pilots in all America. And if a story were to come out in the press that we were not being allowed to fly as pilots...
We want a window.
There could maybe be in future capsules be a window or be a...
No, that's where the hatch with explosive bolts goes.
The hatch with the explosive... Yeah, there could be a hatch with explosive bolts on the capsule.
That is a spacecraft, sir. We do not refer to it as a capsule.
Spacecraft.
Yeah. A hatch with explosive bolts on the spacecraft. There. And there will be pitch and yaw thrusters, which will enable the astronaut occupant...
The pilot. Astronaut, pilot.
Yeah, the astronaut pilot. To have control of the reentry procedure.
Thank you. We appreciate it. You wouldn't mind if we had the press over here take a few photos of us by our spacecraft now, would you?
Good idea, John.
Look, Glenn's waving us in. Hey, what's your problem? All right. Jesus. Look at that.
Oh, Life magazine. You guys ready?
Hold it. Did those guys remind you of any engineers you've worked with? Yeah. I think that this illustrates the danger of inappropriately placing people close to the wrong cores in a large-scale technical program. Fortunately, NASA realized that, you know, obviously they were flying something. And the people who should fly something are pilots, right? Because when it comes right down to it, when things go wrong, when you're upside down and backwards and going Mach 3, you got to be a pilot. And that's the only person that's going to save the day. The right flyer. Has anybody flown the right flyer here? I can't say that I have, but I've flown the simulator for it. And it is an amazing experience. If you can fly this thing for more than about 7 seconds without crashing, you're pretty much an ace pilot. And you're flying it completely just by moving your body around. It's a weight shift and wing warping, and you're just feeling the thing flying or not flying. You're trying to divine what it wants to do. It's a great illustration of something that instructor pilots tell their students when they're learning to fly. Once you've got the monkey skills down, right? Once you've got the things that you can do by rote, they tell you to fly the wing, right? What does the wing want to do? Is it making lift? Is it making a lot of lift? Does it want to go fast? Does it want to go slow? Is it at the edge of stall? Is it coordinated? Fly the wing. And that's what NASA finally decided. They needed to let the astronauts be pilots and fly the thing. And so one of the natural questions that we could ask ourselves is, okay, how did they make that decision? How did they know that it was the astronauts that should be close to the layout of the capsule, the controls of the capsule, that they should be in control of all of that pilot stuff? Well, they had this amazing screening program, right? Everybody in the country knew who these 7 guys were. Everybody knew that they were the best pilots in the United States. I mean, even Tang knew that they were the best pilots in the United States. So obviously there was nobody who should be telling them how to fly this spacecraft. And that brings me to my final point. The idea of proxy, that if you are the person who is gaining this sense of empathy with this thing that is the core, the materials that you're going to use to design this product, service, or experience, you need some proxy that will explain the depth of your understanding to the rest of your team so that they will let you be that expert. They will let you put yourself at the center of the story of how that thing was made, or at least that part of the thing was made. You probably don't have the time to sit down and explain everything that you know in the same detail that you know it. So you have to pick something that will represent your level of expertise, your level of understanding, and what you can do with it. For the Mercury astronauts, it was that rigorous selection process. I worked with a talented team of designers working on something called the Eclipse 500, one of the very first very light jets. one of the things, it was a really fun program. It was a very challenging program as well. The idea was to make a jet that would be built on an assembly line, much like an automobile was. And the attempt was, or the intent was, to reduce the cost of these business jets from $10, $15, $20 million down to something, a more manageable $1 or $2 million, you know, pocket change, right? So this jet was going to be much smaller, much more constrained than the business jets before it. One of the things that was core to the challenge was providing proper lighting, right? Lighting that made it a pleasant place to be. Lighting that made it feel like it was a larger aircraft than it really was. Because here are people who are used to flying business class and first class, and you're putting them in this thing that's about the same size as your average SUV, or maybe just a little bit tighter. And we had to create this sense of spaciousness, of comfort, of ease. This is a guy, this guy here, Bill Stewart, was the lead industrial designer on the project. He spent an amazing amount of time playing with light. And at first, we didn't quite understand what he was getting at. He played with all kinds of different lighting sources, all kinds of different lighting fixtures, got this real intuitive sense of what was possible with light, what effects could be achieved, what unintended effects could be achieved. And then he took a lot of the lighting, the fixtures, the different kinds of technologies, and made a mock-up. We found this old, disused part or artifact of the design process. It was this huge styrofoam block. It was maybe 20 feet by 10 feet by 10 feet. Huge styrofoam thing. We called it the beer cooler. It was carved out on the inside to be a representation of the aircraft, the interior, the cabin of the aircraft. It was a generation or two old, and so the engineers there at Eclipse thought that it was useless. We looked at it, we're like, can we have it? They're like, yeah. Like, can we cut it up? They're like, yeah. I'm like, okay. So we started cutting it up and we started putting things in there. And Bill, who had been playing with light for all of these weeks, built this mock-up of all of the effects that you could achieve with the different lighting techniques. Because people were very skeptical about what we were trying to do. They didn't understand that we could actually make it feel bigger with light. And so what we needed to do was to demonstrate that. And we could see, Bill could see when his ideas were working and when they weren't. The engineers that we were working with could see that they were working or when they weren't. And after this exercise, when people looked at this proxy of design expertise with light, they gave us a lot more room to explore, a lot more room to design in different lighting effects. Now this is an example, this is a proxy that's very close to a prototype, and you may be thinking, oh, proxy, you mean prototype. Not really. Proxy really is this demonstration of expertise. This is very much like a prototype. This is Ray and Charles Eames, mid-century American designers. They did a lot of work with small-scale cinematography. Right here, they're shooting for a short film called Toccata for Toy Train, which is just fun. A fun representation of all kinds of toy trains and children's toys animated through stop-motion animation. They also created a film in the early 50s for a colleague of theirs, Eero Saarinen, which was really the basis of his bid to design Dulles Airport. And it was this explanation of the problems inherent in a modern airport at the time, one that was evolving from being at the human scale and operating for propeller-driven aircraft, one that was in transition to the jet aircraft and their space and noise and all of the other requirements that go along with it. And that 7-minute film was sufficient representation of the expertise that Eero Saarinen was going to be bringing to the design process that he won the commission. So it doesn't have to be a prototype. It can be some other form of representation. If you're an airline pilot, it can be your uniform and your gray hair and your announcing voice that's somewhere a mix between FM smooth jazz DJ and cowboy. We're going to be cruising at an altitude of 35,000 feet here. Sit back, relax. Right? It instantly puts you at ease. That's the airline pilot's proxy that says, I got it. Let me do my thing. We talked about the Romans earlier, the Roman governors, the ones that were out in the hinterlands. I mean, literally, they were sitting out there in the middle of tens of thousands of people who probably didn't really want to be subjects of the Roman Empire. And their job was to convince them, no, you really ought to be subjects of the Roman Empire. In fact, we are the rightful rulers of this domain. And the proxy that they used was a demonstration of both the might and the glory of the Roman Empire, something that the people could aspire to, or at least be in fear of. But that idea of proxy, of showing that you ought to be the person who is entrusted with this, is vitally important for that large-scale, distributed process. So I think that when it comes to designing these large-scale, technically complex products, services, experiences, managing proximity, deciding who are the people who ought to be closest to what parts of the problem is really the key to success. And I think that it really depends on these three essential elements. Empathy, letting people develop this emotional closeness, right, this deep intuitive understanding of some core, the core material that they have that they can use to construct the product, service, or experience. And asking them to produce some proxy that demonstrates that they are the people who should be allowed to develop this empathy with this core, and that should be their contribution to the process. I think that if we're able to do that, we can create teams that design and build and launch excellent products and services and experience, and every one of them can be those heroes at the center of the story of how that thing really got made. And that's what I've got.
Okay, I'd like to remind our audience listening at home that this is the Commonwealth Club of California. Our program tonight is Design Imperatives from the Roman Empire to the NASA Space Program and beyond with Michael Meyer, CEO of Adaptive Path. My name is Kevin O'Malley. I'm chairman of the Business and Leadership Forum and your host for tonight. We're going to turn it over to the audience now for questions and answers. If you'd like to come around, please come around to the back and up here to the mic where I am for questions. Now, I've got a question for you. I'm wondering, you didn't talk at all about your company, Adaptive Path, and you didn't really talk too much about IDEO and Frog, but what are you guys at Adaptive Path doing along these lines? What are some of the clients you're working with that are really hot that would make sense in this thing here?
So we're working with a range of clients. We have some of the kind of the hottest leading edge clients, folks like Twitter. We have some of the bluest of blue chips, folks like American Express. Our deep expertise, our history is all around delivering great experiences through the web. And that's probably the bulk of our work these days is crafting great experiences to be delivered through the web. Increasingly, what we're discovering is that for every company, the web is an important channel. And there's usually some other really important channel. In fact, there's usually multiple channels through which they communicate or interact with their customers, provide services, provide products, or maybe there's some connectivity from the product back through these other channels. And people these days, trying to avoid the using the word customers, people these days are increasingly savvy. They understand that whenever I contact a company, they should be able to remember who I am. They should recognize me. They should be able to recall the last time that I contacted them. They should be able to remember what I like, what I don't like. In fact, over time, they should be able to compile all of this information into understanding so that they should be able to know what I'm going to need when I do contact them, or maybe even before I contact them. People know that this should be true, this should be possible, and it should be possible. Companies are finding it increasingly difficult to actually provide that because people are really, 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 really expectant about it. And it's a tough problem, right? Designing an experience to be consistent through multiple channels is really, really tough. It's a huge technological, I see a couple of people nodding, probably people who have tried these multi-channel experience design projects. So, in the last couple of years, we've been doing a lot of what we call Web Plus One, where we design an experience to be delivered through the web and through one other channel that's of primary importance to our customer or to our clients, and design that experience so that it's coordinated between the two channels, that each channel is optimized for the kind of interaction that's sort of most natural for that channel, and that it reinforces the interaction that you have on the other channel. So these days, the short answer, These days, we're increasingly doing a lot of web-based work, and a lot of web-based work that has to tie in with some other channel, whether it's a physical product, whether it's a retail space, whether it's a product with some connectivity.
Hi, my name's Peter Gisella. I was reading your website, and it mentioned something called a blog indexing that you designed and sold to Google. And
yes, MeasureMap.
And one of the things that pointed out was that it wasn't an overly complex system, that it was more designed to provide useful information. Mm-hmm. Now, my question is along the lines of what you're talking about empathy, core, and proximity. I've been interested in a subject that I call a grand strategy, mm-hmm. and one of my frustrations is getting feedback from experts about it because they're all in their little silos, mm-hmm. and I'm trying to do this in a nuanced, holistic sense, and I don't have the money to get them to think outside their preferred comfort zone. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking about doing a blog combination Wikipedia eBay thing where mm-hmm. I try to get people to volunteer comments and suggestions mm-hmm. on the topic, and if not, put it out to bidding where people could offer some money to pay this person to do it. Mm-hmm. And so you have a combination of volunteering or pro bono effect, or mm-hmm. the more capitalistic one of here's the money and give us the thoughts. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure exactly the right people that would think through that process of mm-hmm. how feasible it would be.
I'm not sure if you need to think through the process of how feasible it would be, frankly. I mean, the idea of using web technologies to open up an idea to this entire world of people in which there has to be somebody who's interested in it, right? So broadcasting it broadly, finding those people who are interested in participating, I mean, that's really the foundation of the open source movement, right? You just throw it open, throw the idea open and out there to whoever would like to participate and let them participate. Be a sort of a coordinating force, but not a controlling force. And I think that's the most difficult part of the open source movement, is that you really have to have the courage to throw it out there, to let everybody share ownership of it, and it's that shared ownership that's going to result in this act of co-creation. I think that if you believe in it, you should just put it out there and see who else jumps on board.
Well, I think that that's true in a lot of cases, but then there's the counter examples of like the financial crisis we're in, where everybody mm-hmm. was part of the herd that was moving forward, and there were some mm-hmm. that made lots of money through The Big Short, where they calculated at some point this was going to go over the cliff. Yeah. It was just a question of how long could they sustain a negative bet until it happened. And but there wasn't a whole lot of supporters for them. And I guess, you know, they did mm-hmm. have some financial investors in their deal, but they were a very, very small minority.
Yeah, yeah, and I think that the critical element in that is that there needs to be, you need to sort of seed the movement with a sense of right and wrong. Thanks.
Hi. So you're talking about the challenges inherent in addressing design problems at increasingly large scales mm-hmm. and complexities. And can you talk a little bit about the difference between controlled, curated, large-scale experiences mm-hmm. and emergent experiences, things where you plant a seed that you have some confidence will grow in the right way? Because mm-hmm. those seem both possible mm-hmm. at large scales, but different approaches.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that that's one of these areas where there is no clear right and wrong. It's more a sense of what's right and wrong for the organization, right? And the organization is not just the group of people who have come together to provide this experience, but also the group of people who have come together to participate in this experience, right? Disney is very much a curated experience, and everyone knows that. Right? The staff that provides the experience understand that it's very tightly controlled. The families that come to the experience understand that it's very tightly controlled as well. And that's what they're looking for, right? They're looking for a safe space that's going to provide the kind of, it's going to sort of promote the childlike wonder that they experienced when they were kids, that they want to provide to their kids. And so they're looking for this tightly controlled thing. And I think that when you match up the organization that wants to provide this curated experience with an audience that wants a curated experience, that's great. On the other hand, you can have organizations that want to provide a very sort of open, collaborative, communal experience, and a group of people who want to participate in that open, collaborative, communal experience. Wikipedia is the example on the other extreme, right? It's not curated except in the sense that people curate for each other. And it's the knowledge that people need to be responsible for their own curation as far as it happens, that I think instills a sense of responsibility. It's like the previous question about how do you avoid this, you know, the unintended consequences of this huge collapse. Well, I think you instill in the community a sense of responsibility and an awareness that that's what the experience is, for good and for bad.
Many companies today like to enter the business market in mainland China. Mm-hmm. And I see that focus on user experience has a lot of advantage over the traditional ways in doing business and building business models. Mm-hmm. And Adaptive Path is one of the earliest leaders in the industry. And I see actually the book Subject to Change and many essays of Adaptive Path are translated into Chinese. Mm-hmm. And the recognize of user experience is really valued in by the Chinese locals. And I wonder if your company has any interest in entering mainland China's business markets anytime soon, or even establishing an office?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Increasingly, we're doing more and more business in not just mainland China, but countries throughout all of Asia. And what we're seeing is that yes, just as sort of the American marketplace went through this sort of emergence of understanding and of valuing well-crafted user experiences, that people in Asia are sort of coming to that philosophy as well. I mean, certainly I would argue that it is a logical step and a necessary step from the kind of the individual product-based competition where people sit down and evaluate, do I like this product better or this product better, to the sort of the experience-based offering where it's all of the intangibles that surround it and the understanding that the company has of the user that are really what lock the people into that relationship and make them not want to look any farther, because why would I?
So you're saying the main challenge is still about understanding of branding in
China? I think it's not, I think it's not a branding. No, great experience design, it's not about branding. I think it's about fundamentally understanding what people want and having the courage of conviction in your understanding to actually craft the product offering so that you're there to like set it in front of them even as they're only just realizing that it's something that they want. I think a great example of that, there's this company called USAA. I don't know if anybody else banks with USAA, phenomenal user experience. They get to know the people that do business with them so well, and they craft the product so well that it's just a natural reaction. If I think that there might be something that they maybe could do for me, I'll call them up. And it's just a given that they're going to be able to help me out. Crafting that kind of experience is just, it's much more than branding. It's all about understanding.
Hi. Hi. Can you speak a little bit more about Web Plus One that you were talking about? I mentioned Web Plus One. I'd like to know a little bit more about that.
Okay. So Web Plus One. Well, as I mentioned, Web Plus One really comes from this. The fundamental realization amongst people, all of us, that companies have at their disposal technologies that they can use to know who we are, to remember who we are, to make their interactions with us consistent, no matter where we come into contact with them. It's only the magnitude of challenge to actually put that into place that's keeping companies from doing it. Web plus one is an effort to make that coordinated, the design of the coordinated multi-channel experience a little bit less daunting, right? Every company, the web is an important element of the experience for their customers. There's usually some other channel, whether it's a retail space, whether it's a phone call center, whether it's the product, a physical product itself, whether it's an interaction through the mail. Web plus one is all about identifying the web and that one other important channel, understanding what interactions do that company's customers have with it that are best suited for one channel or the other, and then optimizing those interactions so that they really are optimized for that channel to which they're best suited, and then coordinating between the two channels so that when I interact through the one channel, I go into the retail space and I go into a bike shop and I pick things up and I feel the weight of it and look at the surface finish, the things that a retail channel are optimized for, that I have some way of taking that understanding away and then interacting with the online store. And everything that I've learned, all of the interactions that I've had in the retail space, will transfer over so that the experience is coordinated. In a nutshell, that's kind of web plus one. Finding the experiences that are best suited for the particular channels, optimizing for those channels, and then coordinating between those channels.
Sure. Hi, Michael. My name is Sudeep Rao. I just wanted to share one observation that sort of reiterates what you shared with us, plus also pose a question that's a little bit away from the traditional product design. Back when I was in grad school in New Mexico, I learned something as I was looking at all these different, in grad school you get all these different subjects and you're trying to figure out, okay, where do I put all these different knowledge, et cetera. But after attending a class in biology about osmosis, about how things move from, across a membrane, about how the transition from low concentration to high concentration, low concentration. And it suddenly dawned on me, it was sort of like an epiphany, that intimate understanding about the basic fundamental processes that happen in nature, like how you said, where does money want to go, where does mm-hmm. that steam want to go, that sort of intimate understanding I got about how do things like, how does weathering happen, how does acid leach something that's mm-hmm. minerals, and so to me it was really nice that you articulated and you're applying it in design, so that's very reassuring. The question that I have, I'm actually an engineer and I find myself in Baby Hunter's Point mm-hmm. trying to design communities, trying to design beautiful communities, trying to design systems that work in healthcare systems. Mm-hmm. And I ponder about how, and I know that in California we have a movement that's looking at, hey, our constitution, there's something messed up in our budget, this and that. We have a lot of systems that we have designed over time that actually are crippling us or actually mm-hmm. preventing us. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious about in the design community, are there people that are looking at it from fundamentally about, okay, let us make something that's sustainable, let us make mm-hmm. something that as a society, as a civilization, we can actually really study mm-hmm. what's happening and design something in terms of a government system mm-hmm. that actually responds to the concerns and the need statement of today. So, I mean, assuming that we are not happy with the status quo, with the situation the way it is. So I'm just curious to see, Tim Brown was here from IDEO a short while ago and mm-hmm. talked about design thinking, but I was curious, mm-hmm. in your experience, if you had anybody looking at design thinking or design and that intimate knowledge about what's happening in mm-hmm. society and applying it to things like systems, like government systems. So, mm-hmm. thanks.
Sure. Yeah, I'm as you were posing your question, I found myself wondering, do I want to live under a government designed by a bunch of designers? Not entirely sure. no, but I think that your question pitches up a design opportunity that is very much the heart of this kind of large scale, technically complex, distributed sort of product, right, for lack of a better term. It's the sort of thing that's going to have to draw on a bunch of different areas of expertise. And really no single area of expertise is best suited to be the final arbiter of what government is, right? I think that for a long time, perhaps we defaulted to, well, lawyers, they study law. They should be the people who architect our government. And certainly there were huge contributions, good and bad, that were made, that came from that community. But I think that as the issues of sustainability, of equity, of kind of distributed participation come into play, it's something that needs to come out of the hands of any single group and be distributed amongst all of the different groups. But then the question is, okay, how do we distribute it amongst these different groups? And I think that's where we have to look at, okay, who is best suited for this particular part of the problem? And instilling, trusting them with that particular part of the problem, and also instilling in them a sense of responsibility that, well, as you're working on this particular part of the problem, it has to interface with this other part of the problem. If you're worried about if you're the person who has the empathy about how money is made, you need to be able to translate it into terms that the guy who's crafting the frying pan can actually understand and can use to make something that's going to be better than the two of you could make together separately.
Radical collaboration.
Radical collaboration, yeah.
Yeah, as an engineering educator, I'm wondering if we could be doing a better job, and I'm sure you'd say yes, so that the engineers are sort of inclined themselves to want to talk to the pilot rather than being imposed upon them. But I was wondering if you had any specific ideas about how engineering education should be changed.
Sure. Yeah, I think, honestly, I think that it's, as far as encouraging engineers to get out there and talk with the pilot or talk with the cook or whoever it is that's using their stuff, I think that they only need the slightest of nudges, mostly to let them know that it's okay. Because I think most engineering students get so focused in on, this is what I'm supposed to be doing, this is the hardcore nuts and bolts. Giving them the nudge to say, it's okay to have this softer, intuitive side to get close to what people really want, and then fold that into the engineering that you're doing. Because I've found that most engineering students, most young engineers, when they're given the opportunity and they see the difference that it can make, are just won over. Just they love the process and they get tremendous results from it. I think creating the space where it's okay for them to do that is really important. My one pet peeve with engineers these days, or rather the engineering culture that we've created, is this culture of releasing in beta. I think that businesses have gotten too complacent, too aggressive, frankly, about releasing products that are not fully engineered, that are not fully proven out. One of the things I remember from my early days of product development is that it used to be for a physical product, you would go through a very robust failure modes analysis, figure out all of the different ways that this thing could break, how it could be misused, and then engineer those failures out. I think that businesses feel so much pressure. I'm not sure that the pressure actually exists, but I think that they feel so much pressure to release early that they've sort of justified this philosophy of, we can release this thing that's really just in beta and it doesn't completely work, and that'll at least put us ahead of our competition and we'll catch it on the back end. And I think that you can't really do that. Perhaps you can do it for some types of products, but for something like an airplane, for example. I mean, which of us wants to fly in, the 0.9 beta Boeing? None of us. So that's my pet peeve, and thank you for the opportunity to air my pet peeve.
Well, unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program now where we only have time for one last question. I would like to say again for our listening audience at home, this is the Commonwealth Club of California. Our program tonight is Design Imperatives from the Roman Empire to the NASA Space Program and Beyond with Michael Meyer, CEO of Adaptive Path. My name is Kevin O'Malley. I'm chairman of the Business and Leadership Forum here at the club. So, Michael, now in your experience over the last I'm not sure how many years, but since you entered the design world.
More than I would care to count.
So from nuclear scientist to Harvard MBA, by way of IDEO, frog design, and adaptive path, which is a pretty amazing pedigree. What is the one thing you see that's now emerging in the design world that we need to be watching for or be aware of?
So one of the things that I'm watching with a certain amount of fascination and kind of glee, actually, is how so many of the techniques from the physical product development community are being co-opted by the digital product development community. It's fun to watch, frankly. And I think that it's leading to much better design, right? I think that digital media designers, the information architects, the interaction designers, the visual designers, the digital technologists, the guys who are out there cranking code, I mean, they're adopting these prototyping tools, these investigatory tools, these design tools that are a page taken straight from old school industrial design, and I think it's wonderful. Because I think that these days, the idea of something being a physical product or a digital product, I think that that's really passe, right? Even the most hardcore physical products have got some kind of network component. Even if the thing doesn't network itself, it lives within an ecosystem of other things that network to other things. Trying to draw a divide between physical product and digital product is increasingly irrelevant, and people are used to having these very tangible, very physical interactions, not just in the physical things that they buy, but also in the digital products.
Well, thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you.
And with that, I would like to thank Michael Meyer, CEO of Adaptive Path. Our program tonight is Design Imperatives from the Roman Empire to the NASA Space Program and beyond. And with that, I'd like to thank our studio audience. I'd like to thank our audience listening at home. And with that, I will close this program of the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating over 100 years of enlightened public discussion.